Welcome to this episode of Better Life Today. My guest today is a good friend of mine, Roger Anderson, and Roger is every man. There's a little bit of you in all of us. You know, you're a father, you're a dog owner, you're a husband. But there's a little twist. You're also the recipient of a new heart.
Yes.
And I guess that describes all of us as well, but in your case, it's actually the case.
Yes, I get it twice now.
Twice. Yes, exactly. So we've had you here before. We'll put up a link. My predecessor, Kip Bradford, talked with you not long after your surgery. So we're kind of wanting to follow up, and I'm ecstatic that you're still with us, and I'm ecstatic to have met you.
Thank you.
So this harkens back to 2018. So tell me a little bit about your story.
Well, it actually goes back to 1997. I got diagnosed with congestive heart failure at 33 years old, and basically a 20-year-long battle. They finally decided that I needed a new heart, and in 2018, October, that came about. And just the miracles that were involved in that is touch on really quick. First off is people have heard the how long it takes for people to get hearts and any
right.
kind of transplant.
I mean, it's quite a list.
It's a list, and people are can be on it for a long time.
Mm-hmm.
And they were preparing my wife and I that I'd be on the list for 3 months to a year on the list.
And what was it like to hear that? What condition were you in? You'd had this condition for a while.
I had gotten actually pretty bad. I was at the point where just taking my dog for a short walk would tire me out. I'd have to take him and stop and rest just to be able to get back. I didn't have the energy. It was sitting around most of the time, being able to do anything, which
was
very unlike me.
Yeah, what was that like for you? I mean, you're a veteran. Inferring in that, and I know you love sports and everything else, so what was it like?
It was very, very frustrating.
Yeah.
The neat thing about it is the Lord still kept my time, me being able to do stuff. I still was able to do stuff at the church, work with the kids some.
Mm-hmm.
But at this point, I could no longer do any of that.
Mm.
And it was a lot of frustration, a lot of time in prayer. The promises in the Bible really helped get me through that. I'm a human. There's always the frustration. Things aren't going fast enough. Things aren't happening the way I think they should happen.
Sure.
But then, you know, you pray and you read scripture, and, you know, God's timing is always perfect.
Tell me a little bit more about that. Tell me about some of the promises that you held on to during that time.
Well, there was one major one, and that one is found in Ezekiel. It's 36:26.
Okay.
And maybe I'll give you a little back. My condition, my heart failure condition, what has happened is my heart is enlarged and it's become hard. So, you know, we think of scripture and talks about, and this actually just fits perfectly and was the one thing that always got me through. And it's 36:26. I will give you a new heart and put a new spirit within you. I will take the heart of stone out of your flesh and give you a heart of flesh.
Mm.
And, you know, knowing that my heart had actually gotten hard, so it couldn't beat properly anymore. And knowing that whatever the outcome, I had the promise of that new heart of flesh.
Right.
And when you lean on those promises, and, you know, the promises that no matter what you're going through, He is there with you. He is in charge. And of course, in my case, knowing every hair on my head, is probably not as difficult as others.
That's right.
But God cares so much that he knows all the details. Mm-hmm. He knows what I'm going through. He knows what I'm feeling, and I'm not alone. And when you have that reassurance and a loving wife and a loving church family, that it's just, you know, that love and support really just can carry you through these kind of situations.
And what kind of situations did it carry you through? Did you ever have times where you worried that maybe you wouldn't get a transplant in time?
Oh, yeah. I was going through some stages of, I would be okay, and then I'd have a sudden drop off. I'd get a lot worse.
Okay.
And then I'd go along and drop off. And I was having these a little bit more frequently. And when they originally said, it's time for a new heart, it was almost 5 months until they actually started doing the testing.
Wow.
And then it was another 9-10 months of all this testing, and literally worried that I wasn't going to get one in time.
Mm-hmm.
But knowing God was in control, whatever was going to happen was for what he wanted. But I'm still human. It's frustrating. But I'll tell you what, I got a lot of support from all my friends at church and my family and just everybody behind me. And knowing about all the prayers, I had people all the way from here to Florida praying for me. And that's reassuring and comforting.
Right.
The miracles, getting back to the actual miracles of the transplant, is we were talking about how long it takes. Well, Pastor Kip had anointed me the Saturday, and we left Sunday to go down to the hospital. He anointed me, and in that anointing prayer, he said, Lord, we need Roger back soon. Please make this go quick. God listens to prayer. I got down there. On Monday morning, I went into the hospital. They had to put a Swan catheter in, and when they got that done, it activated me on the list.
And what is a Swan catheter?
It's a catheter that goes into your neck, mm-hmm. right here, and they can measure the pressures in your heart.
Okay.
And then they can also give a direct IV drip for a medication that goes directly into the heart. So they needed to get that in. I was in there at 7:00 Monday morning. They said, okay, you're on standby. As soon as they have an opening in the cardiocath lab, they're going to get you in. We waited all day, and the more and more we waited, the more kind of anxious you get, and plus not eating at all during that time,
mm-hmm.
Knowing I have diabetes too, and not eating it can be bad. Things were kind of a little frustrating then, but it got to about 4:30, and I knew that they're done at 5.
Right.
This is not going to happen.
Is doubt creeping?
Yes.
Creeping
is in that this is going to happen.
Yeah.
The nurse actually came in and said, it's not going to happen. They've taken their last person up. Literally 5 or 10 minutes later, my doctor walks in and says, I just talked to everybody in the cardiocath lab. Everyone is willing to stay and do your case.
So they had a heart at that point.
No, this was just to get this.
That was just to get that in.
That in. And they, if even one of them couldn't stay,
mm-hmm.
it couldn't have been done.
Mm.
And, you know, I really believe the Lord touched all their hearts. This is a VA facility. They had been there from 7:00 that morning.
Mm.
And it's now coming upon the 5, and they're willing to stay. And, well, they did. They got me finished at 7:30, Monday night, October 1st.
Hmm.
That activated me on the transplant list.
Which can still last.
Now, yes, and at this point, I'm going to be in the intensive care unit at the hospital until I get a heart.
Wow.
And they're still talking 3-6 months, you know, you just don't know.
Mm-hmm. So how long are they able to keep somebody in that state alive?
Well, it depends. You know, I'd heard the stories. My wife and I had talked to people, and you know, it varies. Mm-hmm. One young lady we know about, she was in the ICU for almost a year waiting for a heart when she finally got hers. So it's, you know, at this point, it's up to God when God's timing. Well, Tuesday, spent the day in the hospital. Christy came. We spent the day just sitting sitting in my hospital bed with all the wires and everything mm-hmm. on me. And
what were you able to do in that? I mean, are you able to read? Are you able to play games?
We played. Christy and I played some games. Mm-hmm. I don't know if I read. We watched a little TV. And basically that was my day.
Right.
Christy went back to the motel. She was pretty tired, and I'm not sure when, but I tried to go get some sleep. Mm-hmm. Well, at 11 o'clock Tuesday night, a little after 11, the doctors came into my room, woke me up, and told me they had a heart for me.
And how many days it had been?
This has been just over one full day.
Right.
When they told me they had a heart. And that the next morning, on Wednesday, that at some point they were going to take me over to Stanford Hospital. That's where they're actually going to do the surgery. Mm-hmm. And so basically, you know, and I don't know how they expect me to get back to sleep at this point.
Now, please rest up.
Yeah. So then the next day went, and there's different things involved. The heart was not at Stanford. Mm-hmm. It came in. It was somewhere else. And so they had to wait. So I actually didn't end up going over to Stanford until late afternoon. All the prep. Finally, it was at like 9 or 9:30. They actually took me into the operating room. And I want to mention that Christy and I, my wife, we had actually spent some time in prayer while we were after they got me prepped and I was waiting to go into the operating room. And I've had a lot of surgeries on my ankle, and we've always had this basically same prayer that God would, it's in his hands. He would guide the surgeon's hands and whatever his will happen.
Right.
After that prayer, a peace came over me that I can't explain. It's without understanding. And the Bible tells us that when we fully rely on him. I felt like I had nothing to worry about. And in the operating room, they were getting me all prepped. They hadn't given me anything. I had the IVs in and everything, but they hadn't given me anything to calm me down. And they're getting everything ready. Mm-hmm. And the one of the nurses preparing a whole bunch of stuff over here on the side. And they've got a radio on, and it's really, really quiet. I could barely hear it. Well, a song came on, and she started singing to it. And I said, oh, turn it up. We all want to hear you sing. You know, I was just relaxed. And, mm-hmm. and the anesthesiologist who was sitting right here, and he was doing a bunch of stuff, and we had been talking, and he said, I have been in this operating room for 18 years. This is the heart and lung bypass one. Mm-hmm. And it's serious operations. And he says, in all that time, I have never seen anybody come in here as calm and relaxed as you are. And that gave me the opportunity to share that, you know, we put it in God's hands.
Right.
I have nothing to worry about. And so whatever's going to happen, God's in control. I've asked him to guide the surgeon's hands. It's just a piece. And that opened the door for us to be able to talk a little bit more about what God's done in my life. And, you know, the beauty of it is, one of the things Christy and I had prayed for is that God would open doors for us to be able to talk about what he does. And just all these little incidents.
Yeah.
Successful. It was a 6.5-hour surgery to get the heart transplant. Mm-hmm. Moved out, a couple of little complications. Neat thing was one of them was I had some fluid building up, so they had to take me back into the operating room.
Okay.
Christy had actually gone to get something to eat. She'd come and seen me.
Oh.
She'd gone out, came back, and I was gone.
Right.
And the doctor came in to explain to her the beauty in God, way he works. the week before, when I was down for my appointment, when they told me they were going to put me on the list, mm-hmm. we had talked to a couple who he had his heart transplant. He had the very same thing happen to him.
Okay.
And so we had already talked about it. Mm-hmm. We had been able to get, and she said, yeah, everything was fine. And so Christy had a piece
right.
coming back in. And she talks about the doctors going, I don't think you understand. And she goes, no, I understand. And just continued. Right. Well,
I want to step back just a second, because I'm always thinking about things mm-hmm. in relationship to our journey and whatnot. And I love the fact that, you know, we are broken mm-hmm. and we don't always have that heart of Jesus, yet we're still able to minister to other people. So even before, following that allegory, even before you had the new heart, mm-hmm. you were able to share with other people and encourage other people.
Yes.
So it's not after God fixes everything that we can minister to other. It can be in the process, it can be before. We still have a story to share.
Yes, we do. You know, that's the neat thing is I've met people and I've talked to people who say, they don't have a testimony.
Yeah.
But we all have a testimony. Mm-hmm. And, you know, if all we do is need to share what God has done in our lives. And when we do that sharing, we're not only lifting up the Lord, but we're also lifting up other people and giving right. them the hope and encouragement to trust more in God.
Mm-hmm. And it can also be, you know, our struggles.
Yes.
And being vulnerable with other people. And then I think I talk about parenting sometimes, and we'll be with another family, and their kids will misbehave or something will happen. And I feel reassured in that moment because I don't feel alone. I don't feel like, oh, it's yes. just my kids.
Yes.
And it's the same thing with life. Fellowship is so important. We get to share our strengths and our weaknesses, where God is working, when God is silent. Yeah.
And you know, people don't realize that even in what you might think is the littlest, smallest thing, by sharing others that this is happening in your life mm-hmm. and these are the things you've gone through, they could be going through the exact same thing, and to them it's not a little thing.
Right.
And so you give them that encouragement, and you know what? The Bible tells us we need to fellowship with each other. Yeah. We need to spend time and minister to each other, hold each other up, mm-hmm. and there's no better way than we can do that than sharing what God has That's done right. in our lives.
That's right. And like this, the couple that you were speaking with that were able to tell about their experience, they could have focused simply on, I got a new heart.
Yes.
But they shared some of that journey of there was fluid, there was whatever else, and that information ended up giving some support and whatnot to Christy
yes.
because she knew
yes.
it wasn't new.
So, yeah.
I love it.
Well, so getting back to the story, mm-hmm. I only spent 11 days in the hospital after my heart transplant.
What? That doesn't sound normal.
They expect, you know, 2-3 weeks.
Right.
But, they said the reason that it was 10 days is because there was a wound vac where they opened up my chest, and that had to be on for 10 days.
Okay.
And as soon as they took that off, it was the next day I was able to actually leave. Mm-hmm. And, but while I was there in that 11 days, the surgeon came in, and he actually told me that they had found out Tuesday morning that there was a heart for me. At that point, I had been on the transplant list between 12 and 14 hours. So it wasn't even a full day.
Right.
And the doctors all were saying it's the fastest they've ever mm-hmm. heard of somebody getting a heart. Well, of course, me being who I am, that was my opportunity to say, hey, God's timing is always perfect.
Right.
You know, he got it so that the staff in the cath lab would stay. Mm-hmm. Because they stayed, it opened up that window when that heart came available.
Right.
And then he goes, and he says, you know, we look for three major things. Your blood type, the size of the heart, and the antigens. So we want 2 out of 3 of those to match. All three matched perfectly. He said, it was as if this heart was for you.
Wow.
And it's a God thing. God's timing is always perfect.
Amen.
He knew what had to be done.
Even if it had been, you know, 6 months or a year,
correct.
There would have been a reason for that.
Yes.
You know, how many people might you have touched? So God's timing is always perfect, either way.
You know, and all that time of waiting for them to do the testing and doing all that stuff to you know, where I got frustrated with it, how long it was taking, God had it lined up. And
like, buckle up, just wait.
Yes. So we got that, and 11 days, and the doctors have all said, and they continue to say, is I should be the poster boy on how a heart transplant should go. And I got to say, it's not me. Mm-hmm. There's nothing I've done. It's all about what God has done.
Right.
And the neat follow-up to that is that they talk all the time, and you know, the question comes up is, how is your coping with the different things? Because there is some different emotional things that you go through. Mm. You know, when you think about, you actually have somebody else's heart inside you, and that they had to have passed away.
Right.
You know, and there's the different things, all the different regimen with the medications and the constant trying to get that influx. How do you handle that? Mm-hmm. And you know, the neat thing is every time they ask that question, it just opens the door for me to talk about what the Lord does and how He's such a vast part of my life that He takes care of it. He takes that worry. I'm still human. At times I get frustrated, but seeing what other people go through after having a heart transplant and having none of those things have happened to me, I just continue, thank God. And He has opened doors for me to go different places and talk to different people.
Right.
And in fact, about a year ago, because of COVID, they weren't doing in-person conferences. Mm-hmm. And so they did a Zoom one, and they asked me to come in and give my story on how I've handled it to I think there was 30 or 40 people who are waiting for a heart. Mm. And they had a couple of us zoom in and give our story.
Right.
And the neat thing about it was that was my opportunity to share my faith and how my faith helped me get to the point and where I was today. The very next gentleman who got to talk about his journey, since his heart transplant over 10 years ago, he's now become a pastor. Because of the connection he felt with God, and how much that leaning on God and using His strength and His love to get us through the hard times or any of that.
Right. So what is this? What is this new heart meant to you? How has it changed your life?
It's given me energy. I can honestly say, and I told my wife, literally the next day when I actually woke up, I actually felt better. Hmm. I had just gone through the heart, you know, like to say, they reached in, took this one, threw it away, you put another one in. I actually felt better the next day. And I have just continued to feel better and stronger. I am back to being able to do a lot of stuff.
And I've sure seen it. We, a little teaser, I guess, or a sneak peek, is that we share a church together.
Yes.
So I see you in action all the time, and you are tireless. I know you get tired, but I just see how active you are, whether it's sports or working with the kids or anything.
Well, the Lord really has blessed. Mm-hmm. I have a goal of each and every day of doing at least 10,000 steps.
Mm-hmm.
The Lord has opened it up that I'm now can play softball. I play softball twice a week.
Right.
I work with the youth at the church, and anybody who works with youth knows that you need to have energy and be able to. And for the most part, I've been still able to beat them at pickleball and some of the other games.
So you still have that competitive spirit.
Oh, yeah.
That didn't leave with your heart.
It's there. You know, and the beauty of it is that I was a big part of building the Gateway Church, the actual physical church, prior to my heart transplant, till I got to the point I could no longer do it. Right. And my wife went back to school and we left for a while. But coming back, it reopened the door for me to get back in, and now we're finishing the sanctuary. And I've been able to physically do a lot of the work that needs to be done. And, you know, having that strength, and yes, you get tired and you can get frustrated anytime you're doing building stuff and things don't go right or stuff's not available. But at the end of the day, you still have that feeling of accomplishment.
Right.
And the accomplishment of able to doing work that God has prepared. Mm-hmm. One of the reasons I think it went so fast is because God wanted the sanctuary finished at Gateway. And he's continued to open doors there.
Right.
And we came back and we were able to do it. And, this just a few weeks ago, I was able to go up to the Oregon Conference camp meeting.
Okay.
And work back in the youth tent. Mm-hmm. And, you have a couple hundred kids. You know, we took 87 of them at one point to Bullwinkle's and trying to keep up with them.
Right.
And, there's a joy in that. There's a joy in, God tells us, he created us for good works. He created us to work. And being able to do that again.
Right.
And knowing that what you're doing and working for the Lord in what you do is uplifting others and uplifting God and what he's able to do. Because on my own, I wouldn't have been able to do it.
Right. I love your story, Roger, and I love that it's continuing. I love the physical aspect that we can see in you of what it means when God gives you a new heart, a new spirit. And that's something he offers to each of us.
Yes.
Each of us. But we still get to decide how we're going to use that heart he's given us.
Yes.
And we have the choice as Christians to accept that new heart daily. And it sounds like you're doing the same thing. You have goals you set for each day. You spend that time with him, and that day belongs to him.
Yes, each and every day.
Yeah, each and every day. So thank you so much for your testimony. And folks, we all have a story. We all have that opportunity to exercise our new heart from God. So think of that today and every day, and have a blessed day. Goodbye.